First reading, the one with the telegraph. Say there was that part in Creolese, there was that part in English. Me a man go up a country, me born in New Amsterdam, me live up in school of peace, me go up in school of Lenguan, me live up at a building man, me live up in schools. So, me know the top that I am. So I can't fool me with that one. Alright. So, what is the top? Sometimes I'm a top of my English, sometimes I'm a top of my Creole. Because you know that people, but I don't quite understand Creole. And got some people who I would think they understand English, but not time they not really understand, but they not to look like they understand at all. So I say, alright. So now I talk about what are we got to do? Now I talk about what are we got to think about. And when you look for that screen, you will see we got to have a Creole and we got to have an English. So first thing you will see how we can write Creole. Don't forget that you can't write down. But how do you write down? How do you know how to write down? And not somebody can learn how to write down. Alright? We can't have a title because we said we have to talk about all of the language. We don't want to talk about Creole one because we got enough language we can talk about. And are you here this morning? Body of form, you are tapped, Waro, you are tapped, lift up. And I hear no man, you say, how did you have a Jimmy? Did I hear no man, you got a lot in the morning? Did I hear no man, you want to know? Did I hear that about a Jimmy? Did I hear that about a man? So, we know that at least one of them language are dead. Not been dead this morning. But that we have enough language here. So we're going to talk about all our language. We don't want to talk about Creoles only. Even though we're talking about Creole. Because we can't talk about them other languages. You only have to be used to know about them. But we can't talk about them. We want to talk about, if we want to talk about language, and we can talk about all them cultures over there. All but we got different culture, and so you understand, so you're work, so you're able to do what you have to do. So I will see how language mix up with all of the culture, different culture. I will see how all of you know they're in a language of your God. So that means, you know, say, the accumulated wisdom or the lore of the people. That's true. Everybody live here, everybody got experience here, everybody understand what one in our country is. So, we want to look at what would for everybody. When we start to work on this, we decided we have to look back a little bit. Because in that one, African proverb said, only one fool I look for the past with the left hand, part of the past with the left hand. And I will explain all of that more. But that's an African proverb that says it. So, we think that we are not falling from when we are used, when we look back and see what we are doing, what we really are. We hope that we can read all English and Creole of them, you know. Are you aware of that? Well, are you afraid to put that? First thing we want to talk about, what the church will do, what the church used to do. We want to talk about what make them be able to do, what make the church used to do, and what that really means for us. Okay? Now, long time, when the church people come here, what I want to do, I teach everybody about them thing what they need to do. So, them are trying and blame them and do this, them and do that. And there is that one people in St. Thomas, where we are now for US Virgin Islands. Them timeline, we are called Danish West Indies. And so, the Moravian brothers gave us publications of versions of the gospel. And here was a response in 1836 to one of those publications. With the fair and handsome print of this work, we are delighted more than I can express. Now, not only can the missionary, with far greater convenience, read in public from the printed page, but what is more important, we are able to give a copy gratis to all those of our colored population who are taught to read, and they may peruse it at home for their edification. So the first thing that this indicates is that the church was aware that the people did not speak the language that they themselves brought, okay? If they're not in common, they're not going to go home, right? So that's the first thing about the Moravian brothers. A second bit in 1829, same place again, says, in answer to your inquiry respecting the Creole or Negro English language spoken by the Negroes in these islands, I beg to state that although it is true that among the better educated of the Negroes its use is on the decline, yet by far the majority of the population neither speak nor understand any other language. Any other language. In the Danish church, as well as in our own, divine service is still performed in this singular dialect. And what makes it less offensive to all here than it would otherwise be, and they are, that among those who speak it are the most faithful and experienced members of our congregation. And I want to go on. I want to make it a little bit local now. Reverend James Williams in the 1930s here in Guyana made this comment in one of his books. The Reverend Thomas Yarrow thought that his dictionary of the four languages, Creole Dutch, Karenisi, Akowayo, and Makusi would be valuable to those who came after. In other words, in the 1830s, a priest, Thomas Yarrow was a priest at Vatican and subsequently was a priest in the interior, in the Ubununi, he recognized that there were several languages in the area where he was working. And when you read his diary, he says that if anybody were going there to work, that person would need to know Creole or Dutch, or they wouldn't be able to speak to the population. This is the two-way reaction. That language died, but this man actually did a dictionary of it. This dictionary I have never been able to find in the last 40 years of search. But there is clear evidence that it was done because there is evidence that he deposited it with a local corresponding committee back in the 1830s, I think in 1837, if I were to be precise. But what is important about these four things that I've read is the fact that these people, the church, recognize the significance of the various languages in the community. And remember that their primary purpose was to convert people, to win people to their side, to get people to understand what they were about, what the gospel were about, and to join and support them. And they found that the only way to, the best way to do it was to do it through the language. So they used that people wrote language. Okay? The Luther of Africa. And when next came on the line, we were in the work of India. I really got that guy from the industry of the work office there. He did that in Indra. He delivered industry meeting. And Indra, Brahmo and Brahmo, by somebody that I had there. So we got a funeral. Ready? When we go, we hear them and see. When we are Christian, we are practice. We know Christian here. When we try to sing, we are seeing one thing, then we sing another thing. We are seeing one thing, then we sing another thing. You know what we find out? That the Indian Christian people have been translated all their names in a Hindi. So that when I read them, learn a church, but Christianity in Hindi, they never learn in English. They learn in Hindi. So if you understand what they say, have you got enough things to learn from them church and what the church is for? First thing I will learn, when they use one body language, they understand. Your work. It works for us. It works for them. Well, next thing I learned, people are learning best in their first language. How about you know that? How about you not accept that? How about you know that? That if you teach me the language that I best know, I will learn faster, more effectively, than if you teach me in a language that I did not know. Of course, other people will say, Kurdi is a language. Let me not attend that. But in education, you also learn that you have to start with the known and proceed to the unknown. You have to start with what you know. And if you know this, I doubt you have to use teacher that. Me not say, I will not teach you another thing. But you say, if you want to learn them, and you learn them good, you'll have to start carrying it, yeah, and then carry it where you want to be to go. Alright? And then, one other thing. Our language, good enough to learn it. You can learn any language where you want. People's language reflect their culture. And you'll probably have a keep switching backwards and forward because sometimes I'm sensitive to audience. And I see my good friend Nick Paraclas over there, who is not talking to the Guyanese Creole man of honor, although he's a very noble Creole scholar in our midst. And you'll be enough of Guyanese who can understand the mental health of Creoles. So, people's language reflects their culture. And therefore, if you don't know the language, or if you allow the language to die, you lose important dimensions of your culture. In fact, there's a proverb, a saying that goes, when an old man dies, a library is lost. Now you can imagine what happens when a language dies. And me can tell you about that. Because Charlie can tell you. So when we find my language, what we call Bordis Dutch, 1975, we find out. A same day when National Service is at the first passing of parade, we find them people are Bordis River. And so we got at the house, a first recording for the language. And last year, March, but the 15th, so the last body, what we know about the Tata language, dead out. Similar 98 year and 11 months older today. So as far as we know, nobody in the world who can still talk a language. And we can talk a little bit, but we know, can't say that we are brownies but star. We can't understand them people. And we learn them just so like what they talk with them and so we learn them. Right? So talk about. So, when I did it, we realized what all about. The last friend gone. Couple months before we were in the conversation, she had friends, she said, oh, the sorry we can't talk with you anymore because when we gone, who you were talking? When I left, who you were talking about? We have to get up at night, cool and never look for them, and talk to himself. Okay? Nobody has ever, not talking about the sorry we're going to do. Alright, but I look gone, and all of them people have been noble, do like in a, but this river, all of them. If you go to the next Creole language, the next class Creole language, I guess, if you go to you, the same one about your travel. That is the same thing like about this. The one I guess, if you go to the next call them Skippy Dutch. And Skippy Dutch, the Dutch word for the executive is Skippy. So then people then used to call them Skippy Dutch. And by the time you meet them in 1975, themselves, Colloquium and my name, Alexi King, and Mrs. C, and wife, Susanna King. And then people tell me they don't know to talk a language. I know something. About 8-9 years ago, we come here to teach one class. And we got a girl from Barbados. And when we start to talk about Barbados, I got to say, you know what, yeah, some king came, let me know what she didn't know. So I go look for her. And she tell me she and the doctor from Alexi King and Sudan King. And she tell me they used to talk along the house. She knew Alexi King done dead couple of mornings before we meet there. And she said they used to talk along the house. But they never talk from the bishop like that, none regarding, nobody. They got a couple of words in the government, they didn't even go right, who tell a couple of sentences and so. But she did also. So I was there. And I didn't know nothing for them things. So all that. All right. So, people's language preserves what they know. In other words, there's a whole range of knowledge, a whole range of lore, a whole range of explaining society, explaining how it works, explaining what we do, and it is all caught up in the language that people use. And that is why when a language dies, a virtual civilization is lost. You lose the ability to understand some of these things. You know, many years ago in the 80s, I remember getting a Christmas card from one of the politicians in the country. It was probably the most significant political gift I ever got in my life. Maybe the only one. And it said, this is a translation, it said, the sky is the roof of the world. The trees are the pillars that prop the roof. If you cut the pillars, the sky will fall. This is an American proverb. I suspect it is Makushi, but I don't remember accurately now because I don't any longer have that. But I always remember it because if you want to point it to, was the need for us to understand that people who have lived long years in particular situations have developed sophisticated understandings of things. Can you imagine the people who we seem to feel are under or uneducated could have such a sophisticated idea of the need to take care of the environment. Right? And up to now, we still try to convince the bushes of North America that global warming is a reality. Okay? They just don't believe it. But if you cut the pillars, the sky will fall. So it's a long, long way back that people had ideas, and their culture would have been in those ideas, and they wouldn't be interacting with their environment would have shown that they have some kind of serious recognition of the need to take environment seriously. And then another one of the stereotypes that we have to deal with is the notion that some languages cannot be written. Well, that's simply not true. Anything you can see, you can write. Whatsoever you can talk, you can write down. You don't have to learn how to write down. And I think so when you have English, you have to write down. You don't have French, people don't write their English. Then German, you don't have to write their English. Then Russian, I write something that we can't even understand when we see it. Alright, and that's some funny symbol that we don't know. Alright? So if you want to learn one language, and how to write down, you don't have to learn, just how you have to learn to write English, how to spell English, how to talk English, how to whatever else you have to do in English. Alright? Good. Now look back again. What did education do? Unlike the church, which had a similar mission, because the church was trying to, in their terms, improve the thinking of the people, improve their way of life, improve in their terms. Alright? Education was supposed to provide a way out for the people. What did education do? First to begin, education teaches English, that if English are the first language. Not somebody, not that English, then you come to school. You come to school, and if I want to learn them English, I can learn them English. But none of them are talking them yet. So we have to understand what they are talking them from, and then we have to learn how to use that to make them learn how we want them to learn. English, anything else, and not only English, and blah, blah, blah. And then they used to teach all that in English. If you know English, they will teach you English. If you know Patois, French Patois, they will teach you English. If you know Creolese, they will teach you English. If you know why, whatever, they will teach you English. So, if they're not using what you know, how are they going to teach? They will get you to learn what they want you to learn. When they use what you have, you do not want to learn fictionated and dying, evanous. They don't really know. They go back to the lab and... But, Dinah, our lady who I used to teach at Imperial, Dinah for the top part of Mona. And Dinah make me learn that Patamona and Arecuna and Akawayo, everybody can talk almost the same language. One can talk and the other can understand and so on and so on. But Dinah will talk one and Dinah tell me one story. She said, you see them people when they come to school? They will tell teacher they only understand Vatiana or Waiwai or whatever they will talk to. And when they go home, they will tell them to mind them over that they only learn English as school, they can't learn English as school, they want them to talk. So, they get a little good size. Alright? So, they say that all persons must learn English and English only. Not just learn, they must learn in English only. Now, we could do with that, we could argue about it, I'm sure that there's, there are people who will say yes and no to that. But most of all, it seems to me that what they did was to ignore the Amerindians. Right? Here's a statement from a man named E.J. Latrobe, who in 1838 did a survey in Guyana and some of the Caribbean islands as well. And he's talking about language, about education. And he says, the great and peculiar impediment to the dissemination of instruction, are you hearing the words? The great and peculiar impediment to the dissemination of instruction in British Guyana is doubtless the presence of Dutch language among the Negroes and the plantations. It is a proportion of the population of Demerara and Babis and must continue for some time to retard the process of education even where schools exist. So if you know the language that the people speak, why are you surprised if they're not learning well? If you know the language of the music, why are you surprised if they're not learning well in another language because you're helping them to do so? And then in 1881, Reverend Charles Vance and Bobby Trevor, he says, the children all talk a patois called Creole Dutch and their own Arawak tongue, and scarcely any English. Listen to this. A rule was made to which they all readily agreed that no language but English should be spoken in school. It's a rule that it's the rule. The rest of what is what I find interesting. I mean, the first part is interesting too. The second part is, it was sometimes amusing to observe the attempts of a little boy, or girl, the attempts a little boy or girl to make to reprove a grievance or express a wish, importing into his speech a mixture of the three languages. In other words, it's amusing, it is subject for merriment for other people to be able to laugh at how people get confused in their attempts to use the language. Well, four on what would a drink cup they come for me. Right? What's the word you say? I was doing an interview with a man at Chesney on the quarantine, just outside of Adventure State. And the man was insisting that we would literate. This is what he said to me. We can talk Hindi, and we can write down to it, but English may not know. The literate may not be that school. Notice, not only could he talk Hindi, he could write it, but But he sees himself as a liturgist. In other words, somebody has told him that the only way he could be liturgist is if he's liturgist in English. Right? And I have a special bond with that, but I haven't seen him in a few years now. I hope he's still in good health. But he's the last one. Brothers and sisters still alive. But the man will be at the city and get out. He wanted them. All right. Then, the word I want to speak to them is cool, as we saw in the report from one of the reports I just mentioned. One man actually told me that you see a mix in school if anybody ever heard him speaking the language. It was written by that act of self-denial. You can't talk this language. You have to talk English. You're not talking English, you have to grow their clothes. But you know something. Them teachers themselves attack through a class and don't let you go sometimes. Well, I know we can have a class at Boston. Boston Primary School. Never been a teacher. And when they sit down in the car and say, can you not go to school? They let me, them students will go and talk to them teacher and pick me and so them. Then they never talk, they never play a band or anything. Then they hear one but they talk from and step. Some say, Abuda, I don't want to be picking them. Some look at me look and say, I'm a teacher. I don't know if you hear one teacher tell them picking. You say, what kind of thing this? Then I talk about whatever they talk English and I hear much learn English at school and English at school and I teach them what you want. Isn't that true? Right? So even among teachers, we had a difficulty. I want to make a point about the significance of language and how much we are working for other issues. In 1850, Governor Barclay wrote, no one traveling through the country like this, and so seeing the still remaining effects of there, the Dutch influence over the Indian population could resist coming to this conclusion. Their intercourse with the Europeans was carried out mainly in Creole Dutch, now fast disappearing among the Negroes of the colony. That sounds like a simple thing to say because it is true that the language was used by all blacks and Americans in these areas. But what is particularly interesting for this quotation for me is that it was used as part of the documentation for dealing with the Venezuela border. Because what they said was, if these people use the Dutch language, then it is clear that the Dutch had some kind of control of that part of Guyana at the time. Right? But when we argue about language and the rule of language and so on, nowadays we get very legalistic and talk about all kinds of other things. And it strikes us that, you know, there might be some evidence in the language as well. So, up here now, 1980 something, the red one people by now. But language and the border question. So this one is an important indication of how knowledge and understanding of language reaches beyond the things that we normally assume. Okay? Here it is reaching out into the wider education system. But I'm looking around to see if I see or recognize the chief education officer and the representative here, because I'm hoping that things have changed significantly. I stopped reading in 1954 the annual reports because up to then they all contained this passage, this paragraph. To 95% of the children in the colony, English is the mother tongue. Only in the far interior are Aboriginal Indian tribes found who speak only their own language, started by Luciani, and we did it to the exact spelling, or Macusi. There's perhaps a smattering of Portuguese or Spanish if they live close to the Brazilian or Venezuelan borders. Notice they don't even recognize that these are multilingual people. People are speaking several languages, okay, and doing it with facility. And more than that, they're almost dismissed as people from the interior, way up in the back there. If you want to understand what is going on, you have to go and deal with them as border people. Alright. What do we have in this world? What are we in this world? We know that all languages are good enough for teaching and learning. All languages are good for that. We know as well that children are usually glad to hear their own experiences. Then they are glad to hear about their own story. We know that if you speak to them in the language that they know, they understand more quickly. They will understand more quickly. We know also that language is a resource. And it's an important thing. One of the things you never recognize in the region, Caribbean region, is the importance of language as a resource. I have a little secret that I can now give to the politicians who want to stop the brain drain. If you really want to stop the brain drain, train everybody in Creole. Because all of you will be Creole speakers. You go home hard. Go to another place. Because you don't have to learn English again. So, now my idea is to really want to control the power of idea. Alright? So language is a resource. And we have to learn how to use the resources that we have and how to use them properly in the context in which we exist. Okay. What do we have to do? What do we have to do? We have to learn how to know about language and education. You have to teach everybody more about language and education. And we have to learn about all the languages where they are like that. You have to know about all the languages and the vice chancellor was saying this, or reading to this earlier on. We have to know about all the languages in there. And I will have to learn how that language come here. Or when they're in there, where they're there. And I will have to learn to talk one or two more languages. Not just Creole, not just English, not just Hindi, not just Warao. Not just Akawayo, Patamona, Kalu, Lokono, right? I'll have to learn more language, one or two more languages, how are you supposed to learn? And then, if I do that, are going to respect all of you people and all of you people there? And that makes me use that title of the video. All of you. Language and nation of Guyana, because we want to learn to speak Albany and all nation of Guyana. I would have felt good about that myself. In other words, it's important for us to be self-assured and to be well with that level of personal pride. And we have to learn to treat others better. I really want to speak and treat our human people better. And are we going to make sure that we build a place to make our human pandemic language better? Like a... Are we going to build a place to make sure that we understand language better? Place that an emoji. You notice how they spell emoji there? That an emoji. You, why you? G, J, E, right? U, G. Peter the Eugene. So you come in Eugene, you can learn from his faith. Allah, so there is a place here where we can teach people about Allah. The more we learn about Allah, the more we know about ourselves. Alright, let's go on. If coffee is there, you can never say, I said, why are you hearing? Hear me out. Echo the palm, yende alma, what he happy day, 17, 16, 15. Or say, you see, man, he could cook an apple. That's right. Not too good. But you bake it. Cook up that, bake it away. Alright? So make one mistake there, make one little mistake. Yeah, make a mistake too. And in guys, clothes, that would be, if we've been there now, this is coffee talking to ourselves, if we've been there now, we could have tell all what happened in 1762 time. How are we changed? So they were expanded. If I were here now, I would have told you all that happened in 1763. How we go up the west. Alright, move on. If I have a question, you answer. I don't know what they're doing, they're going to ask questions. But, not going to ask a bad one yet. If it's easy, you'll answer. But if it's too hard, you know, we can try. Yeah? So, alright, I don't know. You done there? You think that'll work? If I don't ask a question, may God.
Our guy
any student who told, complained to the teacher that children were keeping lines in class. And the teachers got the principal to lock down the classroom and search everybody for 9 inches. Because they were keeping lines. So, that, you know, very often that barrier creates a number of issues for us throughout the system. My brother was telling the story the other day of an Indian student of his who, he was teaching him to spell and he was dealing with shook. So after he had drilled the class and all that, he said to one student, spell shook. And the student said, according to Roy, he think. Then he said, somebody is repeating the question. So Roy said, spell shut. He think. He said, sir, shut like only that. That one I shut at the door. Alright? Now, these are issues that impact the classroom. And the fellow was very shocked. But he didn't know in his own mind, but that's what he said. He's making this picture, he's being shocked, and it goes on that he's being shocked. Because shocked is how he pronounced it. Alright, so that's one issue. The other side of the issue, of course, is that we need to educate, to have more informed educators. And I said Ghana is better off than most of the Caribbean countries, except the region of Ghana. It's unrelated to a muscle. In the sense that people who have been educated at UG in the 80s and the, I can speak about the 80s, and I expect during the 90s, certainly had enough exposure to the language of the people and to its significance and its relationship to progress in the society. I'm talking here about purely specifically. So that at least our teachers were supposed to have been better informed at that point in time. But notice that the 1838 report and the 1954 report of the Director of Education still ignored the real language that the students come into school with. You come into school with that, that's what you have to start with. You couldn't do anything else. And in fact, it's strongly believed that the easier it is, this is my condition, the easier it is to learn English if you have a clear idea of privilege. Okay? Long answer. Any other questions?
Good morning.
Morning, Lou.
Mr. Robertson, I just want to ask a question in terms of, we are hearing advocated that the student is best taught in his own language. You refer to immediate references, the reference to Creole Dutch. If you agree that Creole Dutch came about because of the mislearning of proper Dutch, whatever that might have been at that time, then what you are advocating is the teaching of the mislearned language as being more effective than teaching in the original language. I can't see why it should be logical that one would follow from the other. If I understand you to be correct, and if my premise is correct, that Creole Dutch was the result of the mislearning of proper Dutch. Do you get my question?
Yes,
thank you.
Thank you very much. Leo and I go back to boyhood years. But I'm doing the best man ever. I tell you, you never know, you never know. So, you know, you don't want to like, you need to know, you know. So, that we go to the boy. But there is something wrong. The first thing that is wrong is that it was a mislearning of anything. Once you bring two people together who do not have a common system of communication, a system will develop, will evolve. And that system might reflect one or other language. And I'll tell you something about different languages. A lot of them look like English because the words are used, the words used are English words, most of the way, or Dutch. But you know something? You see that same word, this Dutch language we talked about? And I talked about? The word for run, walk, sleep, eat, drink, water, food, talk, fly, fire, you name it. Those words come from one West African language called Eastern Egypt. And I'm glad that the father is here because he worked in that area in Port Harcourt and he knows about that language as well. Those words come from Eastern Egypt. Now, one language. Guyana is probably the only place in the Caribbean where we can see this is the language from West Africa that contributed to this field. Right? All the core items in Robertson come from Eastern Egypt. That's the first thing. The second thing is that the markers, if you want to say plural in Burmese Dutch, you say apu, which is one of the plural items in Eastern Egypt. If you want to say something that is past, you say you add te to the verb, which is Eastern Egypt in origin. Alright? If you want to say her, you say here and love. Here, this will be shot. Okay? So, it is not true that this is the result of a pain that acquired the European language. Yes, many of the Europeans learned these languages and spoke them as well. Okay? So it's important for us to understand that. So the relationship between English and Creole is not one of a language mislearned. It is one which results from a whole dynamic range of socio-historical interaction under the pressure of the power systems that have existed at the time of the formation of these languages. It is very important to understand that. Because if not, you easily end up thinking that they are one and the same. And they really are not. And you know, if you were to speak to a French speaker in French Patois, incidentally, we have French Patois speakers in Guyana. When I used to work here, we took a number of students into Mahdia, and the school of all of Mahdia at the time was a butcher. And virtually all the people, the last time I was there in 2002, a young lady who was, she was not trying something, but she was killed in school when I went to Mahdia the first time. She had never been to St. Lucia. Her father and her grandparents were St. Lucia. And she was fluent in St. Lucia, Papa. And according to her, me a kwanza, a bonde a bonde. She learned that before she learned English. Okay? So that in the interior in Guyana, you have, I think there are some who are children. You have people who could speak that language and could
recognize the difference between that and English. And I'll tell you something else about the Creole languages. It is easier to translate from, as you saw in Burmese Dutch, the Creoleese, the French Creole. Easier than to translate any of them to French or English. I think this is a sign.
Good morning.
Morning.
Just want to ask this question. Do you think that the Guyana Creole language is still Hindi and Hindi as part of the language?
It's what, sorry?
Do you think that the Guyana Creole language is still with Hindi and even the Arabic language?
Is filled with Hindi?
And even Arabic language?
Yeah, well, the thing is, once you live in a society, you will have to, you'll find the effect of all these languages. When I was over there, like one, I lived there too then. I went to primary school and like one. And in fact, I did scholarship, government company, so I did what I want. And interestingly, at that same time, lived in St. Maurice with the school there. And B and what's her name now? The pro vice chancellor. The Shalit. So much part on the scholarship, same year on the one. So I went to the one too. But once you live in a place, you begin to acquire, you begin to affect the language. You're going to be at Lebron, who used to ask for a batter smash for a box of matches. Okay? And we could hear in her talk lots of obvious Hindi words. My colleague, you were there, which I think I see him in the back, you know. Yes, raise your hand if you want to jump. Yes. You were there, we did a paper many years ago, which talked about the Hindi influence on Guyana. And you know, we have a way, we say, the Creoles, we say, Guyana, all right? He was saying that that hand is the Hindi hand, which is has been incorporated into Guyanese speech. I couldn't speak with any expertise on Arabic, and I will confess the ignorance here. But I certainly know that within particular communities, you will find greater or more usage of certain forms. And then one, for instance, in the market area, is something that we call Maswa. Anybody here know what Maswa is? Or is that for strap? Right, I can tell you come from it too. It's a fish trap, and I think it is also called a gibbera in the rest of the country. So if you know gibbera, you know Maswa. But I'm saying that these things do have influence on top of it. So couldn't live in a society and not have it affected by the language.
Sharon, I have a question.
Well, I'm trying to balance the time and the program and the fact that I know you have many, many questions. We're actually at the time when we're supposed to be closing the snap. So let me tell you, before I will take the two questions I see, but what's going to happen after this discussion is you're going to go to snacks, which is down the corridor over there. Those people who are registered to take the workshops running for the next 2 days will kind of go and receive their bags. You see people with little blue bags. If you sign up to take the workshop, you can take a bag because in there will tell you what's going on and a lot of educational material is in there. But let me just steal a little more time to maybe tease those who didn't plan on taking the workshops by telling you what will be in the workshops in case you want to change your mind. After the snap break, we have to set up panel one. And panel one will be Creolese. That's the topic of panel one. A presentation from Professor Keane Gibson up in front here. The role of the plantation in language acculturation. And then Mr. Alim Hussein, our own Alim from our own faculty, the making of our language. we meet him came back, and we're very grateful to have him here. He's sitting in the third row over to this side. Feeling freedom in Quillies, feeling easy in your harness. Three to debating discussions and four panel one. Then we'll have an open discussion again and go to lunch. Because of the time, I suspect we probably can have a working lunch. Get lunch, come back and continue the discussion. Panel two after lunch continues queries, teaching language and literacy in Guyana, but with a slight difference this time in the sense that we're going to introduce to you, if you haven't the information and the experience with it, the idea of sign language. Is standardizing sign language in Guyana a good idea? That's the topic of our first discussion. And then we did not have, unfortunately, I was supposed to get Dr. Alsop's presentation from Jamaica. It did not come in time, so I did not get a set of the technology to show you that. Perhaps tomorrow. But Ms. Dennis Rory Jackenaut is going to talk about the structure of Caribbean Creoles, or Caribbean Creoles, which refers to all the Creoles of the Caribbean, and its influence on students' written English. She's what to do about those errors. After that panel two, we're going to go into the panel on indigenous languages. Mr. Ovid Williams is going to present our environment, is speaking to us. Are we listening? Ms. Maribeth Singh, Mother Tongue Literacy, the Makushi language. Again, we have a third presentation which is supposed to be coming in through video, which hasn't arrived yet. I'm hoping it arrives by tomorrow. Mr. Adrian Rome speaking about literacy in first language. So I know that we're running over time, but because those two presentations haven't come in, this is why I'm allowing you to steal some time from SNAP and panel one. So I will take those two questions I saw. Mr. Bachelor? No, the young man with the glasses was first, and then long time ago he had his hand up. Yes, I'm sorry. Sorry, Henry. And then Henry, and then I saw a hand, a lady in front. Right. So it's one, two, three. Is there anybody in the back? Ali, do you have a question?
Good morning. My name is Asif. My question is, how do we go about getting forests to adopt for language? How do we change the culture of forests in Guyana, especially at a very young age, from growing up to, let's say, a central language like Spanish or Portuguese? Because over the past years, we have observed that persons in secondary school, they are very reluctant in adopting a second language, which is very important. I must say I'm very satisfied to hear that sign language for persons with disability will be a part of the discussion, because I feel that sign language is something that has been on the down low over the past years. And I'm very pleased to hear that sign language is a part. Thank you.
I'm not sure if I heard you. The first part of the question, what is sign language? Which is a lot clearer to me. I don't think I've heard.
That's okay, sir. Yes, I was asking, how do we go about to change the culture and have young persons adapting a second language at let's say, a young age?
Well, if I get the question right, it is impossible to live in the society and not have some of the cultural, what you want to call, baggage. For instance, I didn't grow up in a television culture. I knew how to make kite, I knew how to make all kinds of things. And make coffee with a water seed and a pea seed and so on. And even with wood, and all the great input, and all the great children, salt, and whatever you call it. So I learned those things as a child growing up. Today, everybody has a clicker, and they sit in front of in the box, and they click their lives away. What we probably need to be able to do is to create sufficient information that is based on a proper understanding of our essential self, and make those as available as the other things are. You may not win, but you will certainly give them a hard-won money. Because there's so many things that people don't know. I'll tell you the secret. The last time I was going to the Buddha, she was speaking to Solian before she died. A young man met me and said, he heard I was going to the Buddha's church. And he asked me if I could come up here and teach the Buddha's church. Alright? Well, like people say, never miss the water till the well runs dry. And the Buddha say, you can't take firewood at night to look for something where you can see the effect. Alright? So it's important, I think, for us to consciously work at developing the kinds of opportunities for people to acquire those skills. I hope I'm answering what you asked, at least in part. The second part of the question of reading and observations, and I accept that. That it is good that we recognize all the language possibilities in the region, including especially sign. We certainly need to develop skills among our people which will allow us to be inclusive rather than exclusive, which is what we look at. Right?
Professor Robertson, maybe it would be a bit elaborate, but I gather all of what we're getting is that we need to move towards more efficiency in education, efficacy in education, and that means we have to move towards educating in the native languages. Particularly for the Guyanese students, we don't have a body of literature, if it exists just to teach English, for personal references. But you're talking mathematics, science, and so on. How do we cover that huge gap, where there's a tremendous disparity there?
The challenge for education is both linguistic and technical. In other words, all languages can be made to deal with anything that you want, that people who speak that language want to talk about. When the Russians put up the first thing to orbit the earth, they shocked the whole world. They caught English standing. Some of them were the word Sputnik. And so Sputnik became part of the English vocabulary because they were caught napping. Alright? So that all languages will reflect and adapt to the context in which you want to use them. And what you need is intelligent, coordinated use of it. And one side will acquire the answer. The other thing is that we have to educate the educators as well. Because often they themselves are not aware of the many ways in which you could be seen. Let me give an example. There's a family, or there used to be a family, on Regent Street between Orange Walk and Light Street. If you go there, Mr. Monday, you see a whole production line of kites. They make kites and shape them, one sells twine, one sells paper, one making frame, the other building kite, and some selling kite tail. Now, what is important? Two things are important there for me. One of the people start using armchair and start using you. Right? So that's one thing. And there's at least one person who has been in the money looking for armchair and tree. Right? But people start using that as one. But the other more important thing, I'm trying to follow the answer. The other more important thing is the is that if you look at the kite, it is a master of physics and mathematics, angles, shapes, right? And if you want, you have colors, you have all the scriptures, so you can make a singing engine, or you can make a pulling, I always call it a marble, or you can make a whole range of kites you can make. And those are skills. Some of our students come to school used in my time, coming to school with those skills. What do we do with it? We forget that, and we teach them about angles. Okay? And my own experience has been, outside of Guyana, has been that permanent students react very positively when you take them into that area of their own experience. And lots of things that you need to go through. The daughter of the young daughter of the young person now is a little bit of a very one fair and all. A marvel of modern physics. The way you retain heat, you use the heat of those things and bake away the cake after the pull out the day. So there's a lot you can learn from the experience in addition to other things. I'm saying our educators are about to be re-educated into the resources that are available to them for reaching the range of students that they're supposed to be. Not just our top level students, who we serve this very well, as a matter of fact, they will learn here.
Professor Robertson, thank you so much for sharing. I'm so glad I came because I learned quite a bit. Thank you for sharing with you all as well, because we know that immersion is always the best way to learn a language. My question is, I know that you are in this workshop, I didn't know before I came, but I've learned by being here, of focusing heavily on an integration of the different languages that are spoken in Guyana. What brought me here really as a practitioner was to really try to problem solve the big problem we have outside of academia, and probably in academia as well, in business, of our students or our workers not being able to efficiently and effectively use English. And so I know that you have a focus here, but are you in the Department of Languages and Cultures considering having another colloquium, another workshop, at which you can really together invite persons who are interested, who are being adversely affected? I mean, this is a developmental issue. We have a situation where big clients are saying that they may need to move to another place because they came understanding that we spoke English, and they're not getting that. So are we thinking of considering some other forum where we can actually come together and get to the root of the problem, where the use of English is concerned, because that is very much tied to economical issues and things that, you know, are probably on the burden of governments at this time.
Thank you very much for that question. I have to answer it in several ways. First of all, let me say that I am always willing to come and do things in Guyana. I will do for nothing. But you have to pay the university and the linguistics department, because they would be, and the business, since you represent business will be prepared to put their money where they all want to be. And then they can't just come from hand them out to bring soup. So, if the business community so desires, and I make bold to speak for virtually all the other people that I know in this room who are going to be talking here, once you arrange it, we will be willing to be here. Some of us will have to cost you a lot more than others. But I've made my position clear, and I will be happy and willing to invite people. What I'm saying to you is, the University of Guyana was benefited from it. One, two, secondly, I think that the assumption is probably slightly off key, because I don't think that I said at any point that students should not develop comprehensive English. So that what we're looking for is full awareness, full competence in a range of languages, sufficient to the tasks that they are asked to perform in each case, and sufficient to retain our essential Guyanese-ness. Alright? So if, I think those are the two parts to the answer that I would like to offer. And I know I'm coming to my friend John and do work at the back. I don't see that in the room. But I think I am committed a number of people here. And I'm sure you can, I can speak for most of us in that, for all of us in that room.